What is going on, Mr. Lee here, and welcome to the second part of the agricultural review video. And today we're going to talk about the various agricultural practices paired with their climates and the global political and environmental aspects of farming. So let's get right into it. First and foremost, we have our climates, and I don't like to confuse my students with the six gazillion types of climates that textbooks like to force feed, because frankly, I think they're a bit much. So I like to break it down into four major climate zones: humid equatorial, temperate, dry, and cold. And to a certain extent, these climates form along the latitudes. For example, if you look at the humid equatorial, you'll note that the green is along the equator, and that's because you see the highest levels of humidity along the equator, and for the most part, you're only going to see shifting cultivation in these regions. As you extend further away, you'll start getting your temperate and drier climates, which are ideal for agricultural practices such as grain or grazing. And finally, you have your colder regions up north, and in these parts, you might see your pastoral nomadism. Big Brother College Board also wants you to know which ones are intensive and extensive. So let's run it real quick. And if you don't remember what intensive farming is, you can go to part one of the review. For intensive farming, we have market gardening, so your fruits and your veggies. Eat your veggies, kids. Then we have our mixed crop and livestock, which involves farming and using part of your yield to feed your livestock. And lastly, we have our
plantation.
Not that kind of plantation, but plantation agriculture, which you see in areas who have been affected by colonialism. Then we have extensive farming methods, which generally takes up large plots of land, starting with shifting cultivation. And a specific form of shifting cultivation is slash and burn agriculture, where you burn an area, cultivate, rinse and repeat, and generally seen in underdeveloped countries and not environmentally friendly in any way, shape, or form. We also have ranching, which needs quite a bit of land as cattle need sufficient amount of space to roam about, and you'll see ranching and dairying near each other for obvious reasons, and they're mostly in cooler, more temperate regions. We also have pastoral nomadism, where they live a nomadic lifestyle and they're the most prevalent in uninhabitable areas like the Sahara or Siberia, and for the most part, they're doing some sort of herding or traveling with goats, buffalo, and sheep. The population increase that came along with the second agricultural and green revolution was accompanied with the globalization of agricultural goods, with countries specializing in their own respective products, thus establishing the global supply chain. For example, you have Thailand, who specializes in rice exports, US with their beef, obviously because of our unrelenting demand for Mickey D's, Ecuador with bananas, and Russian wheat. As the large-scale commercial farms take over the smaller family farms, farming technology and tools, aka agribusiness, improves. So yields are going to increase and the land is able to support a larger population, thus increasing the carrying capacity of the land. This is also due to the fact that technology has also improved economies of scale, and I'm sure you all know what that is, but just in case your toddler sibling asks, let's go ahead and break it down. Imagine there's a farming corporation, and with all their cash and investments, they decided to buy more tractors, pesticides, and GMOs, which is going to increase their yields, and the cost of producing crops would be cheaper for the corporation. So they'll be able to make higher profits, and ultimately, this allows the corporations to
make it rain all day long.
This increasingly globalized world is made up of commodity chains that connect the producer to the consumer. So let's use coffee as an example. You got the farmer, the extractor, the shipper, the distributor, and then the final product.
This drink, I like it.
I know, it's great, right?
Another!
I like it too, bud. So essentially, the commodity chain includes all the steps in between the producer and the consumer, and this process is seen in various goods around the world like beef, apples, chocolates, and bananas. There are a few things that contribute to the effective exchange of agricultural products around the world, and those include neocolonialism, fair trade, subsidies, and infrastructure. Think of this as the so-called political side of food distribution. Neocolonialism represents a new form of colonialism that powerful countries are utilizing, such as the US and China, and instead of completely dominating the countries, as they used to in the good old days, now they provide a false sense of political freedom, all the while maintaining relations for the sake of extracting money. Then we have fair trade, and think of this as a contract between underdeveloped countries and the developed countries so that the farmers in the underdeveloped countries have a chance at competing with the big boys. The farmers are also guaranteed certain prices so that it ensures the farmers in the third world countries are not being taken advantage of. Lastly, for this section, we have subsidies and infrastructure, which are both things that are taken care of by the government. Think of subsidies as fun coupons that the government gives to the farmers so that it guarantees certain prices, which incentivizes farmers to produce and to maintain a level of supply. Infrastructure, such as roads and ports, are often built by the government, and this supports the flow of agricultural goods not only in that country, but around the world. But all this talk about increased production ain't all sunshine and roses, and there are some consequences that accompany it. For example, we have land cover change, which means the type of land that covers the area has changed. Mind-blowing, I know. You could see this in the Mekong Basin, which is in Southeast Asia, and notice the tree line in 1997, which is where the green and pink meet, and look how far back it receded in 2010, thus demonstrating that the land cover has changed. So then we gotta dive into the environmental effects of all this farming and irrigation, and these practices can lead to desertification, where the soil is no longer fertile, soil salinization, where the salt covers the land, and this can happen due to improper irrigation practices, increased CO2 emissions as a result of the tractors, and the draining of wetlands for the sake of making space for farmland, which ruins ecosystems. So here's a list of all the environmental effects in case you want to pause and jot them down. And just a little hint for the FRQs. Teachers and AP graders love it when you use terms like ecosystem, flora and fauna, which just means plants and animals, the ozone layer, and deforestation, instead of saying it affected the environment. These phrases make the graders think, nice, this person actually knows what they're talking about. Even though we have all this new agricultural technology around the world, people sometimes wonder why we have hunger in some countries, and this is due to the challenges that we face. For example, distribution is a huge problem as we're not sure how to export food to the poorer countries before it rots. Natural disasters can lead to a loss of harvests or livestock. Suburban sprawl is taking up more and more farmland. And lastly, food deserts exist in certain parts of the US, which means that grocery stores are not setting up shop in the poor regions, and this can lead to a lack of access to fresh foods and malnutrition. However, it's not all negative up in the agricultural realm, and we do have some positives, starting with urban farming, which grants access to fresh foods in metropolitan areas, community-supported agriculture, which guarantees that a community will support a farmer by buying their crops. Think of it as a Netflix subscription service, but with farming, and the effects are that it gives the farmers more money so that they can
make you.
We're not doing that again. Then we have the value-added specialty crops, and I want you to finish the phrases. Orange, strawberry, waka, and all of those are examples of value-added specialty crops because it allows the farmers to charge more for processing the crops, thus giving them more money so that they can
make you.
Last but not least, we have gender roles, and today women make up about 40% of the labor force in agriculture, but in regions where they see a lot of subsistence farming, they make up about 70%, which shows that women are left to tend for their families in these underdeveloped regions. Politically, countries need to provide women with the same rights as men in reference to land ownership, credit, and access to farming tools and technologies so that we can increase yields for women, which would then put us one step closer to ending world hunger. Alright, that does it for agriculture. I appreciate you all for tuning in, and if you'd like to continue reviewing, here are some videos that you can click on to continue your studies. Don't forget, I left a link with the Quizlet in the description down below in case you want to study the vocab terms. Have a fantastic day, everyone.